That sounds like a horrible idea to me. And I'm like, no offense to all my nuclear people out there, but I don't know. All right, so sci-fi, going way out there. So the, I'm a Star Trek, Star Wars fan. I'm not going to debate with you which one's better. I don't care. I just watch both of them, whatever. Sci-fi going out. The biggest issue is it takes so long to get places. So we want to go to Mars. It takes us about 9 months, I want to say, to get to Mars. Then you have to wait another 2 years to ensure the closest path to come back to the Earth. So you're talking like an almost 3.5 year trip out to Mars. How do you send enough food and water for humans, let alone however many humans you need to colonize Mars? That's the big, one of the biggest issues. So that's where, you know, in Star Trek, you have warp drive. That's what warp drive is. Like, hey, open up the cosmos. You know, here comes the Vulcan. Show us some cool stuff. You know, that's what warp drive does. Millennium Falcon did the jumps. You know, they solved that problem of distance with warp drive. So when we get warp drive, what we call faster than light engines, which people are working on. NASA Johnson working on that. I know Princeton has some pretty cool technology. The mathematics for it was actually solved back in the 90s by a mathematician. I want to say he's in Brazil or he's in South America somewhere. But he solved the mathematics for it back in the 90s. So people are looking at it and working at it. But true sci-fi, so true like Star Trek, Star Wars, we're really doing this until we get that. That distance problem solved. You're talking 5 years of getting more true.
I just don't get the salvaging part. I mean, mm-hmm. We can't, we can salvage the parts of this old satellites, but we can't melt in space, right? We can't melt like the
Deep Space Industries wants to get stuff out of asteroids one day, so.
Yeah, is it possible, like, to melt stuff?
I mean, there's two entire companies that are like built towards that. So that's not my specific area. I'm not privy to their technology. I'm sure they're not letting anyone be privy to their technology as to how they plan on doing that. But I mean, that said, we do have 3D printing in space. And I don't know exactly how they're doing it, but in general 3D printing has
to. Once we salvage the parts, there will still be the parts left.
Right.
So we are not actually recycling that much. We are just making more garbage out of the satellite.
Okay, so I understand your question.
Once you take one part out of the satellite, then all of those parts...
The rest of the satellite?
Yeah, we'll leave again.
So, okay, yeah, I understand your question, or your perspective. And you're absolutely right. There's a lot of need to figure out how else we can reuse it. Something that's actually really a major problem for spacecraft in general is what we call radiation hardened. So the further out you get, the higher the radiation field is free because the Earth's gravitational field protects us from the sun's radiation. You have like the solar flares and whatnot. Well, sorry. I'm used to talking to people.
No.
So excuse me. You know, solar flares that come that actually interrupt satellites and that can actually fry components. We have what we call a sun cycle that's about 14 years. So when you actually design for a spacecraft, you're designing for what you call solar mass versus solar min. So one thing that you could possibly do is actually utilize it just for shielding. If you put a dead satellite in front of you so you're always always facing the sun, that's shielding. You can use it for what we call shading. So in the second Lagrange point is where I believe they put the Spitzer telescope, and that's always in the Earth's second Lagrange point, and that's always in the Earth's shadow, so that literally is always cooler than like other, it's always going to be cooler. So when you need shadow, in fact, and like low thermal effects, the second Lagrange point is someplace that we put it. So use it as shielding if you want, use it as shielding, use it as shading. The point is that these are reuse cases that if it's just floating out there, what can you do to work with it? And to put it in perspective, yes, the smaller ones that are coming up are very small. Like, you know, we're talking maybe this big or something. And they're really powerful. But the old ones, those are like bus size. They are huge. What can you do with that? And I'm hoping that AI is going to help me figure that out. And that's what I'm talking about. Savage part.
I'm just wondering, what are some of the cool things that you think are possible with AI?
Cool things possible with AI. Hmm. sci-fi in me, but I love space, and I love, I guess I like those extreme environments. I would really love to see what AI can do to design like an underwater city, underwater work. I'd love to see what AI can do when it comes to mapping our ocean floors and seeing what else is down there, because think of all the ships that were lost, especially, I'm a huge history buff, so I would love to be able to see what other like ships are down there. I would love for AI to figure out algorithms and sensors and things like that to figure out what's going on in the Arctic and the Antarctic. I would love for, for that matter, I think AI is probably doing it right now to look for ancient ruins. So I personally love to see how technology can be utilized to understand our past and our history. So whether that's, you know, looking at tectonic plates, looking at Pangaea, looking at ancient civilizations, like there's, and this is, you know, this is like, you know, this hardcore, like, oh, here's something physical, figure that out. What about like all those like languages that are like dead to us? Like, I would love for an AI just to go solve that. You know, and you're gonna find it's like somebody's grocery list from like, you know, the Stone Age. You know, it's just, that's cool stuff to me. Like, I love how we can, yes, you know, technology is awesome. I can get anything I want when I want, deliver it on service, personalization, blah, blah, blah. But I would love to see it applied to like history and sociology and, like, you know, some of those history buffs, especially like the World War I history buffs, they actually go to France to find like old bullet casings. Like, I would love for AI to be able to go find all those historic artifacts and be able to catalog them automatically so we already know, you know what, this is that type of casing. This probably came from that type of gun. We can actually track that gun back to that soldier, and you know that soldier has an entire ancestor. Like, that stuff I'd like to see. I personally would love to see it applied to history. Any questions? All right, it's wonderful meeting you guys.